Welcome to Faith Memorial Church. We are so glad to welcome you into the house of the Lord this morning. Lots of activity going on today. Of course, we know that we're going to have the picnic in a little while out there, and a great time of fellowship. We come to the house of the Lord today to praise Him and to worship. And the song that we are about to sing as we stand together says, "Come, Christians, join and sing. Alleluia." Would you join with us as we sing?
Oh,
adults can sing that song. Thank you. You may be seated.
Well, good morning. Good morning. It's good to be with you. I've heard that the weather forecast is it might hit 90 today. So I'm glad we're going to have our picnic right after morning worship. So in about 2 hours or so when I let you out. Now, we're looking forward to a time of fellowship together. A lot has been prepared, and we're just appreciative of all that's been done. And we're so glad that with the property that God's blessed us with, we have a place and a space where we can gather, our kids can have fun, adults too, and we can enjoy a meal together and fellowship together. So stay with us. If you forgot about it, or if you were are a guest with us today and you were unaware that we were doing this, you're welcome to join us. We would be delighted to have you stay and enjoy some food with us. We have plenty of food, and it won't be too many steps from this sanctuary, from the foyer, to get to where all the fun is going to be taking place. So following worship service, we'll be together in that way. There are a lot of announcements. Let me just cover a couple of them because I have we have two emphases that I want to give plenty of time for today. And one is a ministry opportunity right here within our congregation. And the other is it pertains to especially joining with fellow Christians in this area and at the schools that are a part of our community for the time together at the pole, prayer at the pole on Wednesday morning. So I'm going to give some time here in just a little bit, both to our children's pastor, Pastor Lauren, and to a person that helps so much behind the scenes with our children, Sally Case. I want to give them some time to share what's on their heart, and then I also want, following that time, for a little bit of a clip to be shown regarding See You at the Pole. So let me just give a couple of quick, informative announcements. For those who have desired membership classes, we met once just kind of in a preliminary way, but due to special activities, we will resume membership classes on Sunday evening of October 8th. So just note that. And then you all are aware of the really remarkable hurricane season that we have witnessed and how fortunate we are that we have been really so untouched by that. But we have brothers and sisters in Christ, friends and family members as well, that have been deeply affected by it. And with the last hurricane, Maria, our churches that are in Dominica and St. Croix have been very, very affected. We don't think, from the little bit of information we're getting out of Dominica, that there is one roof still on any home or building in Dominica. Now, can you imagine that? About 73,000 people on Dominica. And I had the privilege of preaching there, and one of the churches in particular I've seen some visual footage of. And it's just remarkable what that storm did to that very underdeveloped island. So there are tremendous needs. If you would like to give, and you have given so generously over the past few weeks, but if you would like to give, you can give through Faith Memorial, but you can also go to our denominational website. And there's a link there provided on the site for you to share gifts and also encouragement for those folks that have suffered so terribly over this storm's history. So remember Dominica, St. Croix, and our work in the Caribbean. So I think at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Pastor Lauren and to Sally Case. Come and share with us what I believe God has really laid on your hearts. Please give good attention to them. And most importantly, give attention to the Holy Spirit, would you, as they come to share with us.
Am I on? You hear me? Okay. I was going to introduce myself, but I guess as Jonathan has done, I'm Sally Case, and usually Lauren and I are back in the back with the kids about this time, and don't panic, there is somebody back with them now, so they're not back there by themselves. We came to talk to you this morning. We wanted to share a little bit about some needs and some concerns that we have for children's ministry. So I'm thinking that right now you're, if you're not a mom or a dad, you're thinking it's time to tune out here. But please stay with us, because we want to let you know that, first of all, this isn't just mom and dad's ministry. This isn't just Lauren's ministry. This is a church ministry. If those kids are part of our church and you're part of our church, then they need all of our attention. You know, mom, dad, grandma, grandpa, aunt, uncle, teens, even those of us who are thinking, okay, I gave my time back when my kids were little. But you know, we're all a church, and those kids need to hear the gospel. They need to have the love of Jesus shown everywhere they go. And sometimes I think we forget, and we kind of treat those kids like, not second-class citizens, but kind of put them in the background. They're not quite as important as maybe the adults or adult ministry is. But you know what? I think sometimes we get that mental mentality of Jesus' disciples. If you remember this story where they're shooing the parents and the kids away, parents wanted to have their kids blessed by Jesus, but the disciples thought that would bother Jesus, so they're shooing them out. But my Bible says Jesus was very angry. His answer to them was basically, what do you think you're doing? Don't you know that this childlike faith and this childlike heart is what I'm looking for in my followers? You know what? Jesus had such a heart for kids. He was so compassionate, so caring, so loving. And I was more convinced of that than ever when I read the book, Heaven is for Real. Now, the movie does not do it justice. If you've read the book, you know a little bit about what I'm talking about. But the heart of Jesus shows up when a little preschooler, 3 years, almost 4 years old, Colton Burpo, has an emergency appendectomy. Very dangerous. They thought he wasn't going to make it. But when he does, he comes back in the months afterwards, and his parents realize something happened while he was being operated on. He went to heaven. God took him up for a visit. Now, he never died. Medical records show that his heart never stopped beating. But the little guy comes back, and as preschoolers will do, after a few months, he begins talking about things that he had seen when he was in heaven. And he talks about seeing Jesus, sitting on Jesus' lap. He talks about the things that he had seen, rainbows, things that were just absolutely beautiful. He loved it. And then he says to his dad one day, Dad, do you know Jesus had a cousin? And his cousin, Jesus, said he baptized him. He said, I don't know his name, but he's really nice, Dad. And he's thinking, Dad's thinking, whoa, he saw John the Baptist? He said, and he is really nice. Then Dad begins to think, okay, maybe I should start questioning, because Colton was just giving some little blurbs here and there. And Dad says, did you see Jesus and God? Were you in heaven? Well, yeah, Dad. He said, well, did you see his throne? Dad, I don't know what a throne is. He said, did you see like a big chair? Yeah, I saw it bunches of times. It's God's chair. He's really big, Dad. And he really loves us. He really loves us, Dad. He said, where was Jesus? He gets to sit next to his dad. He sits on another chair. But I sat with Holy Spirit. He said, Dad, did you know God's really three persons? His dad is a pastor. He said, yeah, I think I got that. But he kept telling him little stories like this. But I just want to read you a couple paragraphs, because over a period of months and years, the family heard lots of stories, had lots of little quips about what heaven was like. But I want you to hear what the one thing was that Colton brought back with him. So let me, whoops, need glasses for this. Thank you. I will just use your hand. Okay. No matter what tidbits were that were revealed, Colton had one consistent theme. He constantly talked about how much Jesus loved the children. And I mean constantly. He would wake up in the morning and tell me, "Hey, Dad, Jesus told me to tell you he really loves kids." And over dinner, "Remember, Dad, Jesus really loves the children." Before bed, I'd help him brush his teeth, and through the toothpaste, I'd hear him say, "Dad, Jesus said he really, really, really loves children." His mom got the same treatment. And then one night, as we were reading through our Bible stories, Colton decided to end our story with, "Dad, Jesus loves the children." And then every night, that was the theme of the story. Didn't matter what the story was, "Dad, Jesus loves the children." Finally, I had to get him to say, "Colton, you've got to stop this, because when I go to heaven, I'll tell Jesus you did your job. Yes, we know that God really loves kids." Now, here's what Pastor says. Although we got tired of Colton's nonstop message about Jesus' love for the kids, I got to tell you, it did transform the way we approach children's ministry. God really loves kids. So does Jesus. And I hope that's what you can do. Stick your name in there where I said Jesus really loves children. Put your name in there. Lauren would like to share some of the needs that we have. I just want to tell you that Lauren does a fantastic job with what she does. But Lauren's not the only one. She can't be the only one. We've all got to be in there for the ministry.
That was too nice. Okay, so my heart for the kids is, one, that they would know, come to know Christ early and walk with him, you know, from a young age on, and never experience a lot of the heartache that has to come with not walking alongside Christ, right? My second heart for the kids is that they would understand that our faith that we have here and that we learn about and that we teach is not just a Pastor Lauren faith or a Miss Sally faith, right? I want them to understand that our faith is multi-generational. It's something that we all collectively believe in, right? These stories from the Bible are real, and they're something that Pastor Jonathan believes in, that each and every one of us that comes here on Sundays and Wednesdays together believes in and lives out, right? So I don't want them to grow up and just think, well, that was just a Lauren thing, because that's the only person that taught us, that's the only person we heard it from. So in comes you guys, right? We have ages 3 years old through sixth grade back there with us, and we'll have any given Sunday around 30 kids. 20 to 30 of them, 25-ish, will be kindergarten through sixth grade, and then, you know, 5 to 10, depending on the Sunday, are preschool, 3 to 5 years old. I can't teach both of those groups at the same time. I can't clone myself. I haven't figured it out yet. So I need help teaching one of those two groups. If someone will be willing to come help me just teach the preschool lesson or just teach the kindergarten through sixth grade lesson, and then I can be with the other group. Ideally, my dream would be that I could teach the Bible lesson to the older kids and we could break them in half. And then the younger group could get an age-appropriate lesson and summary, right? And the older kids can go a little deeper and dive a little further into their faith and walk with Christ, because they're able to do that. So it just depends on how much help we can get. Again, I'm only one person, Sally's only one person, and this takes more. Right now I've got Anna back there. She helps me with music as regularly as she can, and that's huge. But we just need more help. So if anyone's willing to come back, the kids are great. They're very open to anyone coming. They're easy to get along with, I promise. But if God's tugging on your heart at all, and you'd be willing to help us in any of these areas, please just see me, email me, come find me anytime. Thanks.
Last Monday in staff meeting, as we were going around the table talking to the various pastors as to what their prayer requests were, especially for their chief responsibilities, this struck all of us who were present. Pastor Lauren began sharing what was really on her heart and what the burden of her heart was as far as the curriculum that she has to teach and what she was praying and hoping our children would learn. And Lauren never does this, but Lauren began to cry, saying how she's concerned that especially our preschoolers might not get this message if we don't get some help. Now, friends, we have a lot of folks here, and I know that you can think at some time or another in your life you're either unqualified or that has passed you. But remember this, God has a place for us to serve, and He wants us to serve. And this is a chief importance in our ministry to young lives, is the ministry to our children. So I just pray that what Sally and Pastor Lauren have shared this morning will be used by God to get a hold of our hearts so that we'll help where we can and, frankly, make lighter work of all that needs to be done because many of us volunteer. All right, have you picked up on the plug? Have you figured out that we're after some help? Have you figured that out? Don't want to leave that vague in any way. I don't want you to think, well, we got some good information today. No, this was an appeal for help. So we need help, and we would just encourage you to make yourself available for use any way that God wants you to be used, and I believe He'll be pleased with that. I think at the close of our announcements, we'll look at that See You at the Poll video, but I have two more mentions here. Don't forget the rummage sale coming up this Saturday. That goes to our teen ministry fund, which helps and assists with teens ministry in a great way. But I think I have a recommendation that I shared with Pastor Aaron that I'll share with you. I think next year we might just look for individuals to come alongside and make pledges on an annual basis rather than handling all this stuff, and just see what we can raise. But before we do that, we need not only good items to sell in the rummage sale, but then we need you to come and buy back your stuff. So if you will help us, we will see the ministry to our teens greatly, greatly helped. You know, in every pastoral setting, there are joys, there are celebrations, and there are also realities about which we're thankful and pleased, but it kind of is a double-edged sword. A young man that I have so appreciated over the years of being here is Nathan Staley. I love Nathan, and I appreciate him. And he's really not only a part of Faith Memorial Church, but he's been ministered to from a very young age to where he is now. Nathan is a sharp young man, and because of that, and because of his engineering degree, individuals have and companies have been pursuing him, and one has pursued him, and Nathan has agreed to accept their pursuit of him, which means that Nathan will be moving to the Maumee, Toledo area, and that, as you know, is too long of a commute to be here every Sunday, although I would highly recommend it if he were to come back and visit his mom, Nancy. But this is, at least for a while, he's promised me he will visit, but at least for a while, this is Nathan's last Sunday with us. And Nathan, just remind everybody, keep that arm up, wave that arm. Nathan has been an usher. Nathan has helped us in so many ways. I sure love this guy, and we are going to miss him. So before time gets away from us today, I just want you to let Nathan know you're going to be praying for him as he relocates and as he starts on a new job and a new chapter in his life. Nathan, just know this. I know I'm speaking from this congregation. We love you dearly, and we're going to miss you, my friend, but we'll look forward to seeing you. And Nancy, put the screws to him about visiting, will you? Make sure he visits on a regular basis. All right, let's take a look at this clip, reminding our young people, but also our families, about this important privilege. See you at the poll. Thank you. We certainly want to emphasize, see you at the poll. It's one of the opportunities that we have to share our faith in the public arena and encourage your children, encourage your teens to be a part of this very, very important privilege and opportunity. Let's stand together, please, as we come to the Lord in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, these are appointed moments, and we hold them sacred and dear. We believe that as we come together and worship, we believe that you are at work in a holy and supernatural way. We believe that your Holy Spirit is in this place. We believe that you will not only anoint the truth, but you will transport it to each of our hearts. We believe that you speak, you encourage, you chasten, you discipline, you encourage, you bring along, Lord, in the truth. You urge us onward in the light. We believe these are holy moments. So we come together today knowing that you have already been at work, you are preparing our hearts, and you are here. We pray that you would have your way with us, not only in the word that is shared, but Lord, in our expressions of our faith. Help us to join together in song and worship you, and may our hearts be open before you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's remain standing as we sing.
Oh, I'm running for your heart. I'm running for your heart.
seeking the Lord's heart that much that you want His fire burned in your life. He just invites you to say, come forward as we wait upon you for the morning offering. Aren't you glad for a Savior like that? Amen. Amen. And we need to let the whole world know, don't we? Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, thank you for the worship that we have participated in this morning. Thank you for the music. Lord, our hearts are lifted by music. We pray, dear Father, that you will help us as we go through life, that our lives might be a song to you, a song of praise, a song that lifts you up, dear Father, that others may see Christ in us. Thank you for this opportunity to give. Thank you for this opportunity to worship. Bless our pastor as he speaks to us in just a few minutes and the choir as they sing. Amen.
Tell somebody about Jesus.
Well, amen. Amen. Kind of a theme going on here that maybe we ought to let our light shine and tell the world about Jesus. Amen. As we indeed should. As God has called us to do, hasn't He? We're looking today at Philippians chapter 1, and we're going to start with verse 21 and read through the end of the chapter, which is verse 30. So if you would please, if you would stand with me, we will read from God's Word, written by the inspired writer, the Apostle Paul. I want you to hear especially this first verse. It is a staggering one, but I believe it is not unique for the Apostle Paul, but is indeed what we should know as Christians, be able to testify about as Christians, unilaterally. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. I think we should read that again. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I am to live on in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which to choose. But I am hard-pressed from both directions, having the desire to depart and to be with Christ, for that is very much better. Yet to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for your sake. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that your proud confidence in me may abound in Christ Jesus through my coming to you again. Only conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or remain absent, I will hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel, in no way alarmed by your opponents, which is a sign of destruction for them, but of salvation for you, and that too from God. For to you it has been granted for Christ's sake, not only to believe in Him, but also to suffer for His sake, experiencing the same conflict which you saw in me, and now here to be in me. You may be seated. Speaking from this truth today, I want to share a few thoughts with you under the title, Christ, Our Equilibrium. Christ, Our Equilibrium. And if we don't want to give much thought to what that word means, let me just state that we could use or insert a different word here. Christ, Our Balance. Christ, Our Balance. The Apostle Paul, writing to the church in Philippi, has a few thematic emphases, and one of them I want to mention to you is the notion of very real, genuine, not fake, not somehow exerted by human effort occasionally, but a real, abiding reality of joy. Not only do we see the word joy frequently in this letter, but we also see its accompanying expression, which is rejoice. So we have the word joy, and as this is real in you because of Christ, then the expression of that underlying reality is rejoicing. So if you have joy, then you rejoice. That makes sense? A second emphasis, but really the platform, the foundational emphasis and theme of Philippians is, of course, Jesus Christ. Now, we might say, well, yeah. Well, let me just remind us, and you can look, depending on which version you use, there are at least 20, and likely more, there are at least 20 references in chapter 1 alone, in 30 verses, of Jesus Christ. either Jesus Christ, Christ, or a pronoun that represents Christ, at least 20 times the Apostle Paul relates to the believers in Philippi that everything about their hope, everything about the promises of God, everything about joy, and everything that relates to rejoicing, and everything about enduring, and everything about dealing with their present circumstances, difficult as they were, relate directly to Jesus Christ. Oh, I hope we get that. For the Apostle Paul, there is a real factor that governs every moment of his day, and it is this: Jesus the Christ. Jesus the Christ. So that he can say with absolute genuineness, complete honesty and candor, I don't know which I prefer, to hang around here in life and bring glory to God and help you in your faith, or to go to be with Jesus post-death or at death, which is frankly much better. I'm hard-pressed on both sides and don't know which I ought to prefer, because the reality is deeply true in my being. It is the underpinning of who I am. I live because of Jesus. I am here because of Jesus. I am redeemed because of Jesus. My life has some degree of meaning because of Jesus. I live and breathe because of Jesus. And I have a future hope because of Jesus. And so I don't know which I prefer: hang around here or go to be with Him in heaven. I wonder how many of us truly have that kind of an expression of a reality. I don't want to be indicting. I don't want to be in any way critical this morning. I just want us to examine this. This is real in the Apostle Paul. And I don't believe that Paul's supposed to be the only one that feels this way. I don't believe that this is exclusive to Paul. I really believe that this kind of knowledge of Jesus is represented in Paul as the norm for every true Christian. I believe that you and I should have this same testimony. For to me, to live is Christ, to die is gain. I believe that ought to be our testimony. We therefore, while we're here in this world, need to remember just a few important realities. One, this world, and I don't say this in just a trivial or trite way, this world really is not our home. And if we are consumed and compelled every day to keep putting down deeper roots here, we are losing equilibrium. We are losing balance. And if we become so dependent on this life that any kind of threat of it or any moment where it is in any way in jeopardy puts us in a spiritual tailspin, we have lost equilibrium. We have lost balance. Now, lest anybody go out of here and misunderstand what I'm saying, I'm not saying this life doesn't matter. It does. I'm not saying that we ought not care about it. We should. I am not saying that God didn't give us a natural constitution to want to stay alive. There's something wrong with us if every day we get up and just think, well, I wish this would be the day my card gets punched. I don't think that ought to be the way we look at life. At the same time, spiritual equilibrium in Christ Jesus should help us also understand this life is going to conclude. We will not escape that reality unless Jesus, He'll conclude it, and unless He comes and it concludes for us before our own death, it's still going to end as we know it. This life your enjoyments, your connections that matter to you, those things that you hold precious and dear will either conclude or be altered by a great extent. This world is not our home. How do we know that? Well, another factor to that is this. Because of the invasion of our enemy, and don't think that all the thousands of years since that happened has changed anything. We still live in a world where our arch enemy, if we're in Christ, our arch enemy is operating and in control. Don't forget, this is his domain. Do we understand that? Do we understand that in a very real sense, today in Lancaster, Ohio, we are actually behind enemy lines? Do we recognize that? Do we recognize that this world is not a friend to grace? Do we recognize that? If that's true, and if what God has told us about His Word, in His Word, is true, and if we can count on it and depend on it, that reality shapes our balance. So somehow, by the grace of God, you and I need to keep in balance competing forces or competing realities. What are those realities? Paul talks about the fact that in life he has enjoyed usefulness for the kingdom of God. In fact, the verses that we didn't read prior to verse 21 show us and reveal to us many of the joys that Paul has. Let me just share a few of them with you before we conclude this first chapter. What does Paul say? Well, one of the things that he says is he has joy. And what does his joy consist of? His joy consists of the reality that he knows these people and he knows that they are still in faith. That's a joy. He's glad to think of them. He's glad to remember them. He's glad to acknowledge the relationships that he has had with them that are centered on Christ. Those truths bring him joy. Deep, abiding, platform kind of peace and poise joy. That kind of joy. The joy that brothers and sisters in Christ have, and have especially in sharing those truths with one another. He has joy in even praying for them. He has joy in requesting of God for them. So when he prays and when he brings his requests and makes them known to the Father for the believers at Philippi, Paul says, this brings me joy. There's joy in that. Have you ever looked at prayer that way? That it is indeed a privilege that God gives us so that we can pray for one another and it brings us joy to do so? I'm going to ask you to do one thing. Get hot dogs off your mind and stay with me long enough. Joy. He has joy in knowing that he has had the privilege to fellowship with him. One of the things that we will soon also enjoy is fellowship together, even if we just sit and talk with one another and share with one another and give of ourselves, bits and pieces of ourselves, to other brothers and sisters in Christ, and we walk away knowing one another better. That fellowship is actually participation one with another in each other's lives. The joy of fellowship. Friends, we were never designed by God to be isolated islands, never touched by one another. We are actually indeed touched by God's grace when we are touched by one another. Paul said, I participated with you, I fellowshipped with you. We were engaged in the work together, and that brings me joy. In addition, he says, whether I'm able to come back and see you in person or not, whatever happens, he said, you, just the thought of you and knowing what God is doing in your lives brings joy to me. And in verse, the last of verse 18, he says, "And in this I rejoice." Yes, and I will rejoice. Then as we move into the verses that we read, here is an interesting expression and demonstration of true balance. Let me give it to you briefly. The Apostle Paul recognizes that he has one purpose to live. And friends, get this purpose. He has one defining, one real, one motivating purpose in his life. Jesus Christ alone. So he looks at his life not as the owner of it. He looks at his own life not as the deciding factor about it, but he looks at his life as a perpetual offering or sacrifice of himself to the glory and magnifying of Jesus Christ. So that he can say and mean it. This isn't some false profession, and this isn't some utopian phrase. He means it, friends, and it's real in him. And frankly, that's one of the compelling factors in my own spirit today. He means this, and he says, my life has one purpose behind it and that initiates it. And that one purpose is this, that whether I am living and breathing in this body among you or my body comes to an end either because of natural causes or my life is ended by someone else's hand. Whether I am alive or whether I am dead, the whole purpose is to magnify the name of Jesus and bring glory to his name. Whether I live or whether I die, it is Christ. It is all about Jesus Christ. I pray that we get that. I pray that that penetrates our hearts. Do you wake up every day with the inner impulse? Whether I live or whether I die, my purpose this day is distinct and real. My life is to honor Jesus, to live for him, to be a magnifying presence for others of Jesus Christ. Is that your heartbeat? It clearly was Paul's. For to me to live is Christ. And death holds no looming threat over me, because as Paul would also remind us, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So Paul knew something. You can kill me, and he was in that kind of pressure. You can take my life in a persecuting moment. Because of Jesus, you can attack me. You can throw me to the lions. You can run a spear through me. You can put me on a cross. Whatever you do, you can't kill a dead man. Think about that. You can't kill somebody who's already dead to themselves. That's no threat. It doesn't hold any power over us if we're dead to ourselves but alive unto Jesus Christ. If we live gladly to honor his name, and if death simply becomes the marvelous release to move into his presence, then you just can't hurt that person. Think about that. You just cannot hold sway over the person whose life is centered on Christ. And Paul expresses that clearly in this marvelous text. You just can't hurt me, is what he's saying. But he says, this is my pressure point. This is between a rock and a hard place for me. I don't know which to choose. But if keeping me around, God can use me to edify and encourage and build up the faith of you all and others, then I'll hang around. That's quite a picture, isn't it? Basically, he's saying, as long as I can be useful for Jesus' sake, I'll stick around and I'll vote with that. But if I can be with the Lord, in an unhindered, kind of stifled way. You know, we have some stuff in between being with the Lord. He's present with us. We know that. He's real. But to be in that moment when every kind of veil is removed and the distance is closed and Jesus is before us in a visible way, Paul says, sounds good to me. Now, I'll be honest with you, friends. I have mom and dad on the other side. I have wonderful aunts and uncles, family members on the other side. But friends, they're not my first priority. And you know, better not be yours either. Better not be that, you know, just, you know, Billy Bob and whoever else is over there, so I want to get over there. Friends, it better be better than that. It better be, I want to see Jesus. The one who died for me. The one who, because of his sacrifice on the cross, made hope real in me. And because of Jesus, because of him, I want to see the one who loved me and gave himself for me. I want to see him. Sure, we want to see others. And we will be known as we are, but the bottom line is, we want to see Jesus. Therein lies our greatest hope. So whether I live or whether I die, it's Christ. It's Christ. Can we say that? Can we say that? For to me, to live is Christ, to die is gain. But if I'm to live on in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me. If I can still be fruitful, then I want to live. And I do not know which to choose. I'm hard pressed. But then he moves on to the last statement, found in verses 27 through 30. In other words, on account of Christ, and Paul has been making it clear, it's all on account of Christ. Then he says, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or remain absent, I will hear of you standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. Then he says this, I've got to hit this note, in no way alarmed by your opponents. We looked this morning in our Sunday school class about the fact that perfect love casts out fear or timidity, casts out the spirit of fear and timidity, that we're not to have fear and timidity naming or qualifying us who we are. And here's one of the reasons why. Because in the midst of suffering and in the midst of sacrifice, which Paul at the end of this statement will say is a privilege, it's a granting from God to suffer. Wow. How many times, if we are suffering in one way or the other, and we have never suffered in relation to what the Apostle Paul's talking about, but if we have suffered, maybe some physical malady, some problem, how often does God get the focus, but he gets the focus because we're wondering why, versus considering it ever a granting from God that we would encounter suffering? God gets very little notice, very little attention, all the blame. You ever notice that? Even by people who say, there is no God. As soon as something goes wrong, why did God do that? Or I can't believe in a God that would do that. God gets all the blame, no praise, no motive of, I'm going to live my life for God. He gets that in scant amounts. But boy, he gets all the blame. So here's what Paul says. Let your poise be a powerful conviction to those around you who are leveling on you persecution. In no way alarmed by your opponents. When you stand there, not smug, not arrogant in your own strength, but confident in Christ Jesus and aware of the fact you really can't kill me. Think about that. You really can't kill me. it becomes a sign of destruction for them, but salvation for you. And that too from God. Poise, which is another, it's a synonym for equilibrium. It's a synonym for balance. Poise is the most frustrating thing to the would-be persecutors of the church. To hurl something at us, whether in word or actual wounding instrument, and to see poise, or to hear songs sung, or to see a shining face, or to hear someone say, "Forgive them, Father, they don't know what they're doing." Poise is a sharp returning conviction of the hurled persecution they have sent out. It comes back to them as a convicting instrument used by God. Keep your poise in Christ. Amen. Keep your poise in Christ. Find your balance in Him. Keep your equilibrium in Jesus. For to you, it has been granted for Christ's sake, not only to believe in Him, but also to suffer for His sake, experiencing the same conflict which you saw in me, and now here to be in me. What is Paul saying? Consider it a gift from God to suffer. You know, maybe even our prayer requests say something about us. What are we asking God always to do? Now, I'm not saying we should say, "Lord, give me a no good, very bad, miserable day." No, I think we'd need some therapy of sorts if that were the case. But friends, knowing that suffering on some level, to some degree, will come to all of us, we will not escape it, then how would the Lord, who suffered it all, want to equip us to handle it when it comes to us? Would Jesus ever want it to be our undoing, and would He want it to be that which just levels us and weakens our faith? Would He want that? Or would He want us to respond to suffering by saying, "Jesus, You suffered too. And those who have walked with You certainly have suffered." The Apostle Paul was, it was said of him, when Jesus spoke to Ananias saying, "He will learn what great things he must suffer for My sake." How do we handle suffering? I would pray that we would address it with the knowledge that we have a Savior who has gone through it all for us. He is certainly able, with the aid of the Holy Spirit, to give us the wherewithal to endure it like hardness as a good soldier, and that we too can overcome by one supreme means, the presence of Jesus the Christ. Paul will even say, consider it joy when you suffer. Joy is not giddiness. Joy isn't even happiness. Joy is a poise and a balance that comes by having the presence of Christ in undiminished form, real in your life. Paul knew that. And he stands as a wonderful reminder to us, we can know that too. It is a byproduct of knowing Him. Amen. Well, I've kept you until about a quarter till, but we're the ones serving you lunch. This is a great truth. Friends, this is how I have prayed even in preparation for this message. Father, may Paul's testimony be my testimony. I mean that. May I be able to say, without propping up some kind of internal conflict, may I be able to say and mean it, for to me to live is Christ, to die is gain. May that be real every day in me. May it be true and real in you as well. Father, as we bring this time to a close, we pray that if there's anyone that wants to pray for someone who is on our list today and stand in the gap for them, that we will have that opportunity. We pray that if there's someone who just wants to come and talk to you, Jesus, that they'll feel compelled by your Spirit to do so and in an atmosphere that's inviting for that. So Lord, help us as we stand and as we sing and as we bring this time to a close, may it also be our opportunity just to call on your name. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together as we sing and as we bring the service to a close. And as we're singing, let's just be mindful of this truth and also where our hearts are with the Lord. And let's mean this as we sing it, shall we? Let's join together.
To follow you.
We have folks that we need to pray for, and at the conclusion of that prayer, we're also going to remember to thank God for the blessings of fellowship and food together. I don't know what you pray about God blessing a hot dog. I'm just not sure about that one. Maybe that falls under ask no questions for conscience sake. But nonetheless, so that you can move out, move that way, and be served, because I believe much of it will be ready for you, then we'll just pray here as we dismiss. But before we do that, we have folks that we need to remember. Mary Bird Piles, Paul Wright. Paul is a father to Michelle Williams and grandfather to Andy and great-grandfather as well. And he just found out he has cancer, 3 to 6 months to live. Paul has been in attendance with us, and we're praying without question he will know Christ. So pray for Paul. And then Kenny Reinshield was in a very severe accident, thrown through the window, and we've been asked to remember him. And then Wilbur has some surgery this week, so we want to pray for Wilbur. So let's join together, shall we, and pray for these needs. Father in heaven, you know everything that we face, and you know that while we know that this world is temporary, you've never, ever done anything else but invite us to come and bring our requests and make them known unto you. So we do that now. We pray, Lord, for Wilbur as he has surgery this week, that the surgery would go well. We thank you for what you've been doing in the lives of many for whom we have prayed. Thank you for the good results we've been hearing. We thank you for that, and we praise you. So we're trusting you for Wilbur. We're praying for Mary Bird as well and her needs. And then we ask, Lord, in the name of Jesus, for Kenny, that you would be with him, provide recovery for him and healing. Lord, we don't know his spiritual condition. We just lift him to you. You know best. We pray for Paul. And Lord, I thank you that we've had opportunities to speak to him. And we ask that you would minister to him. We just believe you will, because we know you're after him. We pray that you'd speak to him in a way that he would know he's heard the voice of the Lord. We pray that he will turn to you. We pray that he will trust in you as his Savior. So we lift Paul to you today, that without question, the I don't know will become I know whom I have believed. We pray that he will know you, Jesus, in these closing days of his life, for your honor, for your glory. Now, Father, also the fellowship that we're about to enjoy, we thank you for it. It's all because of Jesus. Nourish us and bless us together as we share a meal and enjoy one another's company. May it be an endearing blessing to each of us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. You're dismissed. Thank you.